school can come to the track when it's wet, and they can't ride it, but they could see where the water goes. And, you know, Sandy, the hurricane, it's a good education piece. This is a great education piece as well, because you get to learn about it. And environmental education is missing, so anytime we get to do it, it's great.
I want to respect your time because it's getting late. Thank you for your time, by the way. I'm sure you're excited to start your holiday.
Mr. Chairman, with your indulgence, a little levity. Our 50-acre site is already a pump track. Every time I go there, there are ATVs, mountain bikes, and they cut through our fence, which is a recurring expense. So I would encourage you to go to our 50-acre site. You'll see it's an existing pump track.
Well, I mean,
the cops can't keep them away.
And in Queens, that's how we have a 406-acre bike park in Queens. Mm-hmm. That the only reason why we got it was because we agreed to try to get motorcycle use out of the land, and we had to take the whole land. It's huge footprint. So there's four PlayStations like this. When we look at a big, large parcel like that, this we would consider a PlayStation. And then these trails would connect all those PlayStations. So the motorcycles came back the second year after we had it all finished and demolished one of the dirt jump parks that we had in there. And before the weekend was even over, the two guys that were in there demolishing it were arrested, and all of the dirt jump park was rebuilt. That's how quick the people that ride bikes loved it so much. I couldn't believe it, like, seriously. The commissioner from Queens came on Monday with Channel 11, I think it was, to do a report on the vandalism, and it was already fixed. They didn't even get a chance to videotape what was damaged. But anytime you have illegal ATV use, think about these things, because these things bring more of the family out. One thing I want to, I can end with, is that there is no generation gap at all in these designs. So whether you're 4 years old on a little push bike, these bikes don't have training wheels anymore. You're learning to balance immediately. They can be ridden on either track. You don't have to pedal. It's low impact, high cardio exercise. So anybody that needs to get back into shape can ride the pump tracks. It's a wellness center for your whole family. So as you're trying to create healthy lifestyle choices in the community, this is a really great piece. And it's very low. It doesn't cost a lot of money to build them at all. As far as a playground, we can balance it there, or that baseball field. I mean, the seasons of baseball, if it rains, there's nothing to learn. And does not year-round. These are year-round sports, and it's also got environmental education attached to it, that even when it's in foul weather, it works. The stormwater totals and everything, if you guys have that, I have.
We just received those this morning.
Yeah,
we're still this afternoon reviewing and getting the final comments for the Planning Commission for plans that were submitted 2 weeks ago,
okay,
according to the schedule. So this plan, you just kind of looked at very cursory, okay, and the first thing was, hey, there's nothing here about stormwater.
Yeah.
I'm looking at Andrew, because we'd had a number of years ago in at the then Sovereign Center some sort of, I'm looking, was it a dirt bike type thing that was in there, where they imported dump truck loads of dirt?
Monster truck.
Was it monster truck? Thank you. We ended up with a huge mess as they were trying to get the stuff back out. Mm-hmm. So I actually was looking at the lease going, okay, wait a minute. I'm not seeing what you're doing, what your responsibilities are about removing anything, is one of the concerns, because the process of removing, you're talking about a lot of the control structures you'll put in for during construction. Mm-hmm. I'm also looking at what is post-construction. When Brian was here, mm-hmm, he talked about needing to replace dirt on a recurring basis. You only replace it if you lost it. If you lost it, where did it go? So that's kind of some of it. We will crunch the numbers on the stormwater to make sure everything seems to make sense there. But we're looking at what happens during construction and what happens post-construction with the stormwater.
Okay. And as far as the takeout of the pop-up park when it's all finished, too. That will definitely, I mean, from me to you and to you, because I have one, and I know the situation that's going to unfold with it. It's very important to make sure that there's a very sturdy agreement that has to do with the removal of the park.
Mm-hmm. How will you be handling, how you have it set up and where the other, I'll say, gathering type areas are? As I look at how the path goes through, we're kind of creating a pocket there on Penn toward the lower part, where the possibility of, I'll say,
illegal dumpers.
I'll say, yeah, just undesirable activities. And I'm not sure how some of the, if there's illegal dumping, if there are, you name it, vandalism occurring to things, how that's going to be policed and patrolled. Is it going to be something that's lit at night to prevent something like that? Because we would want to be looking at site lighting then to ensure that there's not an adverse impact to anything surrounding.
As far as the regular monitoring, the volunteers who are maintaining the actual track itself will be helping with that. Lighting, I can't answer off the top of my head. I can find out for you. I can say also off the top of my head that right now the lot is full of illegal activity most of the time.
So when we have the concern,
we spent a lot of money taking away box spring and mattresses,
and
toilet bowls and sinks. Let me tell you, I can go into business doing that.
Yeah. So our hope is that it will be zero. The lighting I can find out for you. I don't know off the top of my head, but the hub volunteers, the BAMA volunteers, will be out on a regular basis, walking around. You know, whether they're teaching classes or they're checking in with people. Just having a presence will hopefully deter some of that loitering or the lack of better term.
I also took a picture of the park rules for the one I went to. And they didn't have anything about the trails similar to what you were saying here with the rating of the trails. But they actually were looking for people to be safe, responsible, and use common sense. I'm just curious how we're going to enforce that part of it. For the sake of I watched two kids that were, most I ever saw on their track was three at one time. I watched two kids go basically head to head and they didn't know what to do. And I watched one kid get pretty well airborne. There's probably some term for it when he had the bike kind of starting to go sideways. Got it back part way and wiped out. And he was down for a little while. So I understand you wouldn't want macadam. You wouldn't want concrete. I get that. I saw that.
Yeah.
And that was on dirt. But I'm looking for... There they stated their hours were sunrise to sunset.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I'm asking how some of that is going to be monitored and policed.
Yeah.
Are there going to be set hours or...
Yeah, our intention is to only have it open during light time, daytime. Okay. So sunrise to sunset.
But did you not say that there's no fencing involved?
There is some fencing. There is some accessibility. So the entire pump track will not be completely fenced 100% unlocked. There
is accessibility. How do you enforce, say, dawn to dusk?
Yeah.
Well, I'm just picturing...
Just like a community park, we post the rules. We have volunteers out as much as we can.
So that's the answer.
That is the answer, okay. just like any other community space. We do as much as we can without 24-hour vigilance.
Any other issues, commissioners? Yes, Mrs.
Okay, I had a few questions, some of which were brought up. One comment, I would hope that whatever film is used would be screened, not just for the composition, but for any contaminants in some point.
Mm-hmm.
I know you mentioned trash and recycle, something that we had brought up about it. So you're going to have a number of receptacles, and whose responsibility is it to...
The bike club staff and volunteers.
Very well. Mm-hmm. Okay, I was going to ask about the fence. There's an existing fence on the Penn Street side. I don't remember on the Cherry Street side what there is. But
there's no fence there.
I didn't think there was, right. But on the Penn Street side, obviously you have to have some access, so is the existing fence going to be partly cut out or replaced with something else? Do you know?
I believe the main access is going to be across from the playground.
Yeah, I mean, to me, I think fencing in is good to go. I would fence it in, personally, but this is your guys' call and your guys' call. If you want to enforce them to make a fence on it, I highly recommend it. Not just because of the vandalism or anything like that, it's just, it's safer to be, like, if you, I have two little twin 4-year-old kids, like, you know, the last thing I want to think about is, like, if they just explore and go down out onto Cherry Street, let's say.
Part of our fencing decision was looking at pedestrian routes and making it accessible.
We used to have a fence on Cherry Street. We just gave up because they drive in and knock it down because they wanted to park there.
Yeah. So just imagine.
And the other side, on the other side of this area, there's also a playground.
Yep.
So we're hoping that there's some cross usage of families out using the space together.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think. I personally don't think it's a good idea to not fence it, personally. But
the
fence on this side can be constructed. It's not hard to do. The one that's over here is definitely damaged and could be repaired. And, you know, there could be a gatekeeper. There could be somebody that comes in that just the gatekeeper. That's it. That's all he does is just make sure people utilize the park with harmony, you know. In Philly, in our pump tracks there, we also have a bike park in Philadelphia, in Fairmont Park, and it is a 5-year lease with the city. We don't have a fence, we have a post rail fence around it. It does have a gate and it's locked, and nobody really destroys it or anything like that. We haven't had anybody dump stuff on there, but it was a huge illegal dump site prior to the pump tracks being there. And I also talked to Brian about the insurance, like you were mentioning, may require them to have a post rail fence around the pump track towards the marriage of the multi-use trail. That way if a rider comes off of it out of control and there's a lady carrying a kid in a stroller, they don't collide. Those are some of the things that the underwriters just look at immediately. So,
and we'll look into that when we look into the insurance
question. Well, and then part of the discussion we had the last time on the fence and the gate was the enforceability of not having the motorbikes. I remember I brought that up, and then it was suggested that somehow that could be structured in a way, I don't know how, they could be kept out because you want to make it accessible.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know how you would, other than posting the rules and having the volunteers,
mm-hmm.
and I was going to ask about lighting because it goes to all that sort of thing, and then that a related issue, and I don't know if this is a problem or not, it's just something to think about, is the use, I guess the pathway is one thing, but of the tracks themselves by skateboarders, and I see a lot of them in that area, and I don't know if that's a problem or not, and I thought also about after hours of having the, I don't know if they're, to what degree they're benches or whatnot, but there would likely be homeless people. Maybe that's not such a bad thing, it's just, it presents some issues, challenges. So I don't know to what degree you want to address those. And then finally, the plans changed on the garden as far as the location and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
We understood it wasn't a community garden where people rent plots and plan to, I mean, is it still a similar plan? That part hasn't changed, and it's going to be maintained. It's going to have certain, you mentioned native species and so forth.
Yeah.
You want to elaborate briefly on that?
So it'll be a community garden, not, again, as you said, of the community renting plots, but rather being used as a community space.
Mm-hmm.
So, forgive me, Destination Paradise is going to be maintaining and overseeing that, and then bringing in different groups in a kind of controlled, directed way to work with the garden.
Volunteer groups, or
school classrooms.
Right, to involve the community.
Exactly, to be a community center versus a rental space.
Okay, thank you.
Any other topics, issues?
Skateboarders do use it. Skateboarders can skateboard on the clay. we built a dog park with pump track in it for dogs, you know, because dogs like to run. Runner's World did a huge article on our park in Cunningham, in Queens. Joggers went right onto the pump track and started running around on the pump track. And they love it. And sometimes it's kind of difficult because there's 30, 40 people running around on the pump track. And you're like, where are their bikes? They went, oh, we don't have bikes for a running club.
So that could be before this meeting happens again next month, we're all going to, no.
It's for bicycle use, really, but there is like a small little acceptance into this. Other alternative transportations, like Razor scooters or rollerblades or what might come out, I don't know. People invent stuff every day. But all types of bicycles can ride the pump track. It's not just you have to have a pump track bike. You can. I rode the city bike on the one in Brooklyn right after they put the bikes on or on the street. Immediately I went and got one and rode the track with it. Worked fine.
Jason, are you stretching?
I want to say, I talked to Brian about the whole fencing thing.
Okay.
And that becomes an insurance issue. But now it's a private, not a community. Because me and Brian looked up for, me and Brian have been doing this for years.
Let me introduce you. This is Jason, he's the manager of the bike shop.
Me and Brian went through, because we've been doing this whole pump track thing for years. And he said, as soon as you fence it in and lock it, it's not a community park anymore. It's a private park. And that's where the insurance goes. And then with the dirt, you said about dirt on the acres, we got dirt, we got a contact them again because we lost it because they were holding it for us and then they needed it down at Bird Grove Park. That's when we get our dirt from it. We don't use all your acres. But like I said, with the fence, I like the fence to keep people out, but then it becomes a private park. It's not a community park.
So we're going to explore. I'm going to ask my site engineer.
Okay.
Thank you, Jason. Yeah. Jason has been crucial in keeping the bike club open, so thank you for
I think sometimes, and again, checking that out, but I think there are ways of getting around that where you are open, like you leave it open for 24 hours once a year or something like that. I mean, you know, that there are sometimes that can be worked into the, so that it doesn't become a private, but it's a public.
So if you state what the hours are, and during those hours it's open.
I don't know.
Well, I mean, I'm looking at it, and I think that's what we have at the regular parks we have anyway.
It relies on posted policies more than anything.
Mm-hmm. And that would be separate gatekeeping from the fence around the track that you talked about for the safety concern. It's a separate.
Yes. Yeah, that's
concern.
The entry,
okay.
Entry gate.
Right.
Well, entry right now, there's an entrance. Where the board's at, right there next to the end of that board, they cut the fence so they can walk through. And right there at the entrance.
But they do that constantly.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, I don't maintain that fence.
Mm-hmm. This, the multi-use trail also is 10 feet wide, and it's wide enough for an ambulance to come in either direction on either side. So as far as building the tracks, we do think about that in case something was to ever happen. An ambulance can come right through the whole park from one side to the other and cross over the sidewalk if they have to.
You mentioned at the very beginning that you had gotten a grant to do this.
Mm-hmm.
One of the questions I would have is, because we've sort of run into similar situations where nonprofits have done an improvement somewhere, mm-hmm. but then when it came time for the maintenance afterwards, it was mm-hmm. lacking, and I understand you don't have volunteers and all, but will you have funding to do?
Yep, our plan is to continue to pursue funding, just like a kind of what nonprofits do, which is to just continually find new funding sources. That's our plan, is to continue aggressively looking for continued funding and to make it work, like we've done with the Bike Hub and the projects under the Bike Hub. So we feel very confident.
But you haven't been really, you haven't. I mean, you've only been in existence a short amount of time, so.
Well, we've been open for about a year and a half.
Well, that's what I mean. I mean, to say that, you know, you have those funds.
There's probably not grants for the ongoing operation.
Exactly. That's where I'm going. That's the problem. In many cases, you can get a project done, but it's the responsibility of the nonprofit then to maintain that in, you know, as long.
But Mike, I can answer that. Redevelopment Authority has a seat on the redesign Reading board.
Okay.
So I attend all the meetings. And Brian's goal is, and we've told him that, that he has to be a sustainable organization.
Right.
So he's trying to create all these other things so he gets recurring income to do various things.
And what nonprofits do, right, what a nonprofit is to solve creatively the problems that you're bringing up. That's what nonprofits do, and at Redesign that's
but not always successfully.
Yeah.
Well, I think that so far we've been successful.
Well,
we hope to continue that. And
Mike kind of knows a thing or two about
nonprofits. Yeah. Mr. Lauter is very experienced, believe me.
But I guess what, you know, from the Redevelopment Authority standpoint is, I think if I was doing this, you know, at least that somewhere in there I would put something in it. If you're not satisfied with what's going on here, that you can terminate this agreement.
And the conversation is between, you know, Redesign and the Redevelopment Authority to work out some of the
I learned a lot today. I had no idea. As I said, Brian spoke to us conceptually, but I had no idea what a bump track is, but at least now I know.
But I don't want to sound negative. I really think this is a wonderful
idea. It's a great thing.
You know, it's just I'm coming from the side of the devil's advocate, so to speak, because I've seen it too many times where things have gone in and then they're left to go, and you know, and it's either the city's responsibility to take care of it, which means it doesn't get taken care of in a lot of cases. So
those points that you bring up have been a part of our conversations and thoughts, and for sure.
Okay, good, thank you.
And I appreciate the Commission's concerns, because Redevelopment Authority is spending thousands of dollars maintaining vacant sites, illegal dumping, this, I mean, everything. So I appreciate the comment.
I wanted to say, you said about your concern with maintenance. We have kids that come into our shop right now, and it's every day. They need a tooth, they need brakes, but they can't afford it. So that would be another maintenance thing. Hey, can you go up to see if there's trash in it? You know what I mean? We have the kids, we have the power. I would sign a paper and guarantee for a year that would save me.
And that's right.
Just from the community. Well, I'm just saying, because you know what I mean? I understand what you're saying, people. Yeah, people are all high condemned and lose it. But the kids that come to our shop, that's what I do, because I know kids can't afford stuff, you know what I mean? So I'm like, hey, can you sweep up, or can you take a bike apart? And then I give them their tooth during the break. But I guarantee you.
Makes sense.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
And Jason mentors those kids too, so then it becomes an education and leadership and all of these other things.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, and that's very important, because you know, I live on the corner of 5th and Spring across from Turkey Hill. So even though I have a trash can in front of my house, you know, I get at least 5 to 6 potato chip bags, miscellaneous cans and bottles and stuff. And I think if, I'm sorry, I forgot your name, sir.
Jason.
You know, if Jason, you know, starts sending these kids out and saying, hey, you know, you got to go clean up. you know, that word's going to spread you know, we got to keep the city clean.
It's going to be helpful. Two kids that would just come to the shop, and I'm like, look, if you do a little work around the shop, you do a tube or that, and they bring friends, they say, I need a tube. All right, can you help me do my shop? You know what I mean? It did grow out of the city. I mean, it's every day, Monday through Friday, kids are there willing to help out, so.
This is the Philadelphia tracks as they are right now, okay? At first, it was supposed to be just this track. This is a signature track that I built. I'm a freestyle artist, BMX freestyler, and it's very advanced. The club that brought me in here wanted an advanced track and only an advanced track. And I said, we need something for the seeds, though, right? We need for the kids. So we put a beginner track here, and we instituted a program, which Heidi and Ken and all the guys down there have piloted for me called Dig to Ride. And you have it right on your shirt. It says it right on the t-shirt, Dig to Ride. If the kids in the outside of this area right here, this is Fairmont Park, the Mann Music Center is back here. So this is like a 200-foot high hill right here. We now have a mountain bike trail that goes from the bike park up into the center here and connects to the Wissahickon trails because of this. But the kids that live in the neighborhood are very poor. They don't have bicycles at all. So we put a Connex container on top of the dry well, and in it are like 30 or 40 bikes. The kids come in, they sign in, and then they go walk around. We call it a Jericho walk. They walk around and observe and become more aware of what they're riding on without riding on it. And then they pick up the litter, they fluff the rain gardens, the mulch, they take care of the plants, and we tarp the tracks there. So they learned how to cover it when it rains. And what I've learned from it is that it does make the people around there more aware of, you know, being clean and picking up garbage and taking care of it. But then those kids get to ride bikes that they don't have, and they can't take them home. The container was broken into, and the majority of the bikes were stolen, and the community got all the bikes except for two back, you know, and which was pretty amazing, because the people that did that were women. Like, the parents of the kids that saw us build this went around the neighborhood and got the bikes back and brought them right back to the container. Which was really cool, because not a lot of those ladies ride the bikes, like ride the tracks, they just hang out. So the Dig to Ride thing, I think, could definitely happen, especially with your shop. It's like a turnkey that's done. You don't have to pay to use Dig to Ride, you don't have to do any of that stuff, it's just something that came out. One other thing that we do to build more self-esteem with the people and the children is, when you go around the pump track, you don't pedal. You pump the ground. You push down on the bike, like you might have seen people pushing down on their bicycle and going over the rollers and into the undulation and gaining momentum from that. When they can go around this track four times without pedaling, they graduate to the advanced track. And by doing that, we give the little kids like a little red, white, and blue medallion, and it's got like a little gold wheel on it, and they get to wear it all day. And they also get their name put on a board that they, you know, graduate. So I think that's really cool. It was just kind of a thing at the end of the day. One day we were like, how are we going to do this? I'm like, well, we should make them dig. Oh, you think they're going to dig? Yeah, I think they're going to dig. I mean, if you give them something fun to do, if they ruin it, like you're saying about maintenance, if they ruin it, it's in their face every day. And then you can come along and say, why aren't you taking care of this? We're giving you the opportunity to use this land. So I think there's a little bit of resurgence, and the more and more we get to do this around the country, the more and more the kids are going to appreciate where they live and not litter. I mean, it's happening everywhere. Like, you know, we'll give them all your address.
Yeah, send them up.
But I think at the end of it, the Dig to Ride thing with the hub, as far as generating ownership, is something that will happen instantly with the track.
And the hub is so, the bike shop is so geographically close to this, too. I think that's another.
Well, again, thank you very much. It's been a very enlightening presentation.
Thank you for your time.
And be excellent.
If there's any referrals that you may need from a development standpoint, Two Chains would be more than happy. Pass her information out from the internet. Like I said, they bought the Domino Sugar Factory. They're taking it down. And it's a very, very hardcore construction process because it's right on the East River. So there's a lot of passive demolition they have to do. And our pop-up park is something that they're very amazed with. You know, they bought a master site plan that was approved, and it was really terrible with the people before them who were going to build there in the community. For 125 years, that whole area in Williamsburg has been locked from the community. And now we've opened it before the developer gets to open it to the community and put in place these trends that are not common. And the underwriters, believe me, I have to explain what a pump track is so many times, but they get it. And, you know, it creates healthy awareness. It's a lifestyle. Mm-hmm. Whether they grow out of it is, you know.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, folks, this was a review, correct, Andrew?
Yeah, I still contend that this is not a land development plan for the commission's yes or no approval, but there are a number of land development issues that we need to continue to review and consider, at least on the staff side. If the commission feels it needs another presentation on this at some point.
Yeah.
All right, commissioners, we have a request for a special presentation of a dialogue on an issue, and the chair has consented. These folks have waited a few hours, and until we are at other business, this was not all on the agenda. We have a committee man, I believe, of the first board who wishes to address us with some comments. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Board members and any interested parties that are here on the Planning Commission, as I stated in my summary of complaint, as you all are reading, the ineffective notification to the first board representatives and the citizens and the first form family-owned businesses, merchants, the negative aspects of the dollar store general operating in the low income, and also the traffic and parking congested locations of the streets and intersections in or close to the proximity of 6th and Bigamy Streets locations. The lack of communications to the first ward elected leadership was very little or none. City of Reading Planning and zoning have neglected to extensively research and survey the first ward logistics and existing established family-owned businesses that would be impacted negatively with the dollar store at this time and location. Not to mention the opportunities of crime to increase in the surrounding areas to this location would most likely affect citizens and employees to become a nuisance to our community. Based on this petition, it clearly states for itself, and I have several signatures from the local business owners and other elected officials who are aware of this now, of the response to the actual site and moving forward with the planning and so on and so forth. I respectfully understand that this project has been underway for some time. However, it wasn't really brought to our attention that it was moving so progressively and so quickly, because there were times where there were rumors and that there were some problems as far as variances and zoning was concerned, with the issues of the docking and so on and so forth, and things need to be looked at into further. And there are so many other things that need to be investigated here that I have knowledge to, that I'm not really going to bring up at this time. But again, I wanted to present this to you, and the next person will be zoning. This is the planning part of things. And I did present it, as I said earlier, to City Council yesterday. And I do have some support as far as the things that I've discussed at this point. Any questions? Any response?
Hey, City Council, sir, I spoke to the city clerk. Apparently they showed you or provided to you all the notices duly posted, photographs, and all the documentation?
No.
That's what I was told?
No.
Immediately was, you were not given those things?
Even prior to this committee meeting yesterday, I should say council meeting, the fence circumferencing the property, I've only seen one sign, and I've mentioned it, 12x14 of the zoning hearing that was taking place the same day that I saw it, and I didn't see it prior to it. So I'm not sure how much time went by between the hearing and the actual time it was posted, but I've never seen any type of notification on that fence line in that area ever. And I live literally 15 feet away from that parking lot. I played in that parking lot when I was a kid. I played in that market as I was a kid. I know the neighborhood in and out, and I'm very observant to what takes place in that neighborhood.
Well, when you called, I was the one who answered your phone.
Correct.
The zoning administrator was sitting at my desk, and I think he said more than once that all the necessary postings were made. He has photographic evidence.
I want to see it.
Yeah, city clerk also told me that all of that was provided to council.
How could there be? I'm not questioning what you're telling me. Maybe you were misinformed. I'm there every day, and I have never, and I quote, never have seen an obvious or conspicuous sign posted on the circumference of this fence. Now, if you can prove me otherwise at this point, I'd like to see it.
I was provided a lot. I was communicating with the zoning. That's his title official, zoning administrator. Mm-hmm. I was provided with a photo dated August 4th.
Okay.
Showing up.
That's it?
That's it?
That's a postage stamp in the middle of a football field.
Bear with me. And on that, I'm trying to read the zoning hearing date by making it big enough.
Yes, I read that sign. It was the same day
August
it was being 12th, held.
I just want
to
see.
I had no time to get there.
There's a legal protocol that you have to follow for notice the zoning as far as planning. And they're basically similar. You have to.
No, they're not.
They're not.
They're not at all. And let's not speculate on these kinds of things. I have not seen this evidence. I heard both opinions, but let's not get into this.
All right. I'm not speculating, and excuse me for being wrong. But there is legality on the time when the notice has to precede the meeting. There's also, I think, if I remember, a ruling on the size, the height of the font of the type. There's a minimum.
I agree.
And there's a posting and so forth, and how many hours and how many days prior to the hearing. And that, I had a suspicion that was all complied with because it's routine. All the commissions know that, and the directors follow that very closely.
That is a zoning thing, not a planning thing.
The zoning is advertised in the local newspaper.
The zoning and everything else.
The 30-day period is given for any kind of public comment.
All right.
Yeah, school boards, they have their regulations for posting notice, planning commissioner. All public agencies have their
rules. You said you have some evidence of this shortcoming that you're not prepared to discuss tonight.
Sure.
Okay. I advise this commission to leave it at that for tonight.
Mm. Especially since it's zoning, it's not.
Yes.
Agreed. No.
Just so you do know, there is in our zoning ordinance, it does lay out how many days it has to be posted, what the size of the sign. And a lot of those things are dictated by state law in the municipality planning code. The other thing that you bring up about the community businesses, zoning by law is not allowed to take competition into account when they do zoning variances. That is established law. That is, they just cannot take that into account.
Understood. That's okay. Free enterprise.
Yeah, it's a free enterprise thing. And actually, there has been a traffic study done for this site.
Okay. I have one more question. If you are finished.
Yeah, I'm finished.
Off the top of everyone's head, how far down are they digging down for that foundation?
That's going to be a slab thing. They have to fill everything in.
Are you aware of the caverns under that property?
Yes.
Yes, they do.
We know. There's a basement.
Amazing, isn't it?
Okay.
But that's...
And you bring up a good question, sir, with Mr. Chairman, if I may. For years, I forget the lady's name who was the community leader. Very, very nice young lady, and I met with her several times.
What year was that?
What year? A couple of years ago.
Okay.
And she brought to my attention that the risk that the local community children face by getting lost in one of those sub-basement caverns, as you allude to it. We bought two truckloads of stuff to cover it all up.
Very good.
And let me tell you, we put that fence up around the property. If we have repaired it 10 times, I think, every year somebody drives in.
Really?
And I have to get somebody in to pick up box spring, mattresses, everything. Construction debris.
They throw things
over
the fence.
And then I get complaints to my office.
Sure.
Codes gets involved. I get cited because I'm the property owner. And it's not once or twice. I'm talking about 5, 6, 7 times every summer, every spring. It's a continuous thing.
Right. Well, I respect everyone's opinion and everything that everyone had to say here and so on and so forth, but I'd like it to go on record that I'm against it. I do think that the dollar store operations in the community and the surrounding areas are a wonderful thing. I frequent them. I do like the dollar stores. I just don't agree with the location. And that being said,
can I ask a question
sure.
of you and everybody that's signed here?
Sure.
What do you think would be a proper use for that land? I mean, what would you think would be something that you would feel would be good for the community there that would not impact as you folks seem to think?
Well, I have a think tank as well as a bundle of information that's in proposal stages. It was primarily ideal for that area, that location of 16 Bingham Streets, prior to the dollar store getting involved with there. I was elected in 2014. I even had these ideas subject to that site, and that would be the aquaponics projects for profit. And I'm sure you're all familiar with that. The larger metropolitan areas, especially Philadelphia with the larger buildings, are doing the tanks in the abandoned buildings and factories, and they're doing very well with it. I can't see that there would be any reason that we couldn't create 30 to 40, maybe 50 jobs with a large location such as that. And that type of thing would be, it's a green thing. Mm-hmm. It's a good thing. It's giving back to the community. It's creating jobs. It's creating entrepreneurship for the community. Who doesn't want fresh fish and fresh vegetables?
We are researching that for the last year and a half. Representative Cal Pajarone's office is involved. And in fact, we have contacted two entrepreneurs who are already involved in that. But the problem with that is, as you say, the best infrastructure to use aquaponics is old factory buildings. And we were looking at the Reading Hardware building before it got sold to the people who bought it, because it has the poured concrete floors, which can take a lot of weight for the tanks. But we are pursuing that, and that's absolutely the way of the future.
That was my goal, to get an industry of some sort, right, to create jobs in that neighborhood and create more of a positive role model scenario for our generation in that area, because it is a somewhat borderline high crime area, illegal activities and so on and so forth that we're trying to curb. We are doing the best to do that. But not to get into that subject, again, the proposal that's been instituted prior to this, I understand, is very far into the process of being approved and breaking ground. And I don't want to make enemies, however, I'm looking for resolution. some way, somehow. These family, I know this is not an issue for zoning, but these families will be impacted by this in some way, shape, or form. And based on the support that people give these dollar stores, even in high traffic areas, isn't you know, within the expectations when they built them. For instance, Buttonwood Street, they're really not getting the support that they
need. Not the same thing.
I agree.
Sir, let me humbly tell you,
it's similar.
Dollar General and Family Dollar are not the same thing.
Yeah, no, there's a difference in products.
There's a huge, the I Family the Dollar
yes.
is 40% of their revenues is food. And therefore, I mean, I know the economic development directors of many of these cities. Chester County is allowing two in the most most underserved areas because they somehow stabilize the neighborhood.
Because I see of your
the,
point.
Yeah.
With the Family Dollar, they have a wider variety of
absolutely
of products that are home-based products, from the clothing to the home goods and so on and so forth.
Right.
And the food, the amount of food is a lot less than the other products. I do agree with you, they are a better store, in my opinion. I don't want to jump ship and lose my cause here, but I am in agreement with you on that. I'm skeptical, and I am against that project being there, and I said my piece, and
okay.
Thank you very much.
Are you new to the area, like in the last four or five years?
No, actually, I was born and raised in Reading, Pennsylvania, okay. Across the street.
All right, so you remember the old market.
The McCracken house. Building that McCracken bought. It 407 South 6th Street is right across from there.
So
I was in that market with the farmers and the bakeries and everything as a kid, growing up, crawling under everything and having fun.
And you should also know, the commission knows, there is a 25-30 car parking lot across the street that is also going to be part of this development, which will be given to the city to take some of the parking congestion off.
So directly across from that lot,
lot
that's being frequented and used by the neighborhood right now?
Yeah.
Oh, they're not going to be happy about that, but yeah, I understand.
Well, that's owned by them. That was owned by them.
Understood. No,
there's the illegal gosh park there. There's a boat. There's a boat.
Welcome to Reading.
This is a snowmobile.
But I believe what we were told anyway, the Family Dollar is mm-hmm. going to continue to allow that.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
There is a parking issue there.
Yeah.
In that neighborhood, very much so.
Yeah.
Well,
do you recall that in the previous administration that there were efforts to put in a Latino market in that building prior to the fire?
Right. Correct.
Were you aware of that? And the city was making conscientious efforts towards that. And they were having difficulty. Then one of their employees came by and torched the place. And, there went the plans.
I do remember when that structure caught on fire. I was not living in the city of Reading at that time. But yes, I do remember that was a very big fire. Historic building.
Right.
You could have made two roller skating rinks in there.
Yes.
It was a really big place.
The fish stand on 6th Street. You remember you opened the door?
Sure.
Bought the fish?
Ampton was the market for a time. It was selling blinds.
Oh, right. Well, we thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, folks. We have more work to do, and we have to get done here. Feed the dog and get up tomorrow morning. We have an approval for reaffirmation for Aramark parking lot, which we previously reviewed. What do you need on that, Andrew?
Yeah. I'll make the motion for the to approve the reaffirmation of the Aramark parking lot so that it may be recorded.
Second, please.
Second.
The second question, the motion. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anyone opposed? We are unanimous. Review the draft.
Say no.
Last month's meeting, the minutes.
Minutes. Got to find them.
That means you have no comments, sir?
No, I do have. I should have emailed them.
Anything, Mr. Beeler?
Yeah, I have 1, 2, 3.
Do you need soil? We have a big sign-off tonight that we have to complete.
I have 3 minor grammatical corrections that I can send via email.
What page?
Page 3, under the South 6th Street Family Dollar.
That's a surprise.
Yeah.
Where?
Line 5, it says, Mr. Ludgate said, "They reflect they Harbs." I think it's supposed to say, Mr. Ludgate said, "They reflect the Harbs."
Right.
Okay.
And then about 2/3 of the way down, Ms. Anderson said, "They agreed stagger."
To stagger. We have that.
And yeah, okay, great. And then a little bit farther down, Ms. Anderson that.
Said.
Yep. And I think said is supposed to be inserted there.
Great minds think alike.
Okay, great. That was it. Maybe Will thought of some more.
I think
done some more. But.
One more.
Oh, another one.
On page 4, the top paragraph. Yeah. You see Harb the third time, there's a line that starts, Mr. Miller clarified that there'd still have to be, I think should be in there, a final plan phase.
I think I meant they still have a final plan phase, but either way, something needs to
they'd
be
still added. Have a final plan phase. Well, I guess it could work either way, but it just sounded clear to put it that way.
Anyone else? Boy, now we have 2 commissioners be busted on our man, Andrew.
Maybe now there won't be.
This guy's a nasty.
That's good. Maybe I won't find mistakes years later now.
All right, do we have a motion in order? We've made all the due corrections. Can the chair entertain a motion?
I move to approve the minutes.
That's correct.
And who seconds?
The October 27th.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded by all the troublemakers to accept the remediated minutes from the previous meeting.
I represent.
Are there any questions on the motion? All those folks in agreement, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? We are unanimous.
I returned to the office this evening to find minutes of your special meeting.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Oh, yeah. Good.
You should have had those.
Yeah. We'll do them next month.
It would have been helpful.
Yeah, it would have been.
To review our professional recollections. That's not just in the planning staff.
Well, I didn't write them.
I know. That's my point.
Okay.
Do we have to approve these?
Well, yeah, do it later, I guess. I'm going to, based on this and talking to a couple of you, I will reserve 2 numbered resolutions for this meeting. It's not marked on here.
You will
not.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I will reserve 2 resolution numbers for those actions.
Oh, okay. Got it. Okay.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
We're just to have a separate resolution for acceptance of that of the minutes.
No, we'd have to review them.
When you review them.
We'd have to read them.
Yeah.
Next month.
All right, next month. Okay, that would be better.
Mr. Beeler, Mr. Cianfusi,
have to
argue over.
Yeah, we have to
ask more corrections.
You know, you were all there. You know what you
said. Superintendent. This to me is an action item. But
would you like to rep hand them too?
I received a separate email from you.
We will review the minutes of the special meeting next month.
Sounds good.
Okay. After perusal. All right. Anything else, Mr. Miller?
Not for me.
We have a sign-off tonight, I think.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
I neglected to say something earlier to Andrew. This is an informational thing. There was a notice that came across through PennDOT's system for the e-permitting that there has been a time extension for the jet set to complete what was approved with their highway occupancy permit. It was initiated by PennDOT staff based on what came across when I signed into the system. I have been communicating
on a somewhat frequent basis every month or so to see if they have received anything, because one of our conditions for municipal improvements agreement is that we want to ensure PennDOT requires some surety. I'm looking at Andrew, about 20 grand, if my memory is correct, for the work that needed to be done there, and we for the driveway aprons. So we wanted to ensure that they did not do the work required by the city on the site without addressing the access to the site. So in dealing with the municipal improvements agreement, we want to see evidence that they have provided financial surety for the driveway work. That has yet to be provided to PennDOT. So at this point, we have not executed a municipal improvements agreement with them, waiting to see that happen.
Hold your breath. How many years is this going to take?
I make no representations. I'm just presenting the information that there has been a time extension granted for them for an additional year.
So additional year? Before or after the supernatural plan? What's the
The Nemo's parking lot also had a time extension, and I'm trying to remember if they have addressed theirs. They have received a time extension about a month before.
They built that already, didn't they?
Already having benefits there.
PennDOT, for Nemo's, PennDOT did an inspection, and they had a couple comments for things to be addressed.
Corrections?
Yeah, they did a couple things that need to be corrected.
Only a couple.
I did go on examine the site.
Anything else, folks? You've all done very well.
What's it? Oh, no. No, we don't meet again until February, I think.
Oh, good. I mean,
is that the Planning Commission?
Yeah, well, we only meet four times a year now.
Are we going to entertain a motion for adjournment, or shall we do that?
No, let's do this for another hour.
Tomorrow morning.
I make a motion to adjourn.
Motion made, duly seconded. Adjourn. Any question or motion? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 And we are unanimous. Everyone at the peanut bar, Mr. Lauer's bar.